just for me. Good morning, New Life Empowerment Ministries. Let us get ready to read our scriptures. If I can get everyone to please stand. I'll read the first scripture, and then y'all read the next scripture after that. To the chief musician, a psalm of David, the servant of the Lord, who spake unto the Lord, the words of this song in the day that the Lord delivered him from the hand of all his enemies and from the hand of Saul. And he said, I will love thee, O Lord, my strength. I will call upon the Lord, who is worthy to be praised. So shall I be saved from my enemies. The sorrows of hell compassed me about the snares of death, prevented me. Then the earth shook and trembled. The foundations also of the hills moved and were shaken, because he was wroth. He bowed to the heavens also and came down, and darkness was under his feet. All. He made darkness his secret place, his pavilion round about him were dark waters, big clouds of the skies. May the Lord have a blessing to the readers and hearers and doers of his holy word.
Intercessory prayers. Repeat after me. Father, in the name of Jesus, thank you for grace to be in your service this month of February. Father, in the name of Jesus, thank you for bringing us this far in this ministry and in our lives. Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank you for the freedom to worship you freely and openly. Father, in the name of Jesus, we pray for the lost souls of the world. Guide us with your spirit to invite them to church. Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank you for loving us first and for sending a Savior to us, in the person of Jesus Christ. Father, in the name of Jesus, we pray for the end of gun violence in this country, for preservation of lives. Father, in the name of Jesus, we pray for the sick and shut-ins in this land. Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank you for prayer and fasting testimonies that are forthcoming. Guide us to pass the tests. Father, in the name of Jesus, bless the federal, state, and local governments in this country. Let your will be done. Father, bless our pastor, empower and anoint him afresh to bring your word with power. Father, thank you for hearing and answering our prayers in Jesus' name. And everybody says, amen.
Let us pray. The Lord is my strength and salvation. Who shall I fear? Father, we thank you this morning for believing and loving us enough, Father, to send your only Son, Father, to save a wretch like me, Lord. And Father, we thank you that he came with all power. And Father, we thank you that he died and rose again. Lord, we thank you this morning for our strength. And Father, for the wisdom to come out and serve you, Lord. And Father, we thank you for keeping us safe through all the dangers seen and unseen through this past week, Father. We thank you for allowing us to be here to assemble together so we can dwell together in unity, Lord. Father, we thank you for our pastor this morning, Lord. Father, as he bring your word this morning, may you lure him down in the treasures of your word, Father, and let our hearers hear what it is that you have for us, Father, and that we not only be hearers but doers of your word, Lord. And Father, we thank you right now for those who could not make it this morning, Father. Strengthen them, for you know what they stand in need of. Father, we ask you right now that we will be better Christians on tomorrow than we were today, Lord. Father, we thank you for all that you do in our lives, Lord. We ask this and all of the blessings in your Son Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you.
Amen. Give God some praise. We're able to get one song out of them. Amen. Amen. Do me a favor. Do me a favor. Give God some praise this morning. Let's try it again. Try it again. Let's try it again. Let's try it again. Let's try it again. Let's give him some praise. Hallelujah. 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 You may be seated in the presence of God. Amen. 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 All of you all, look up here. Look up here. The ones in the grave can't look. They can't see, they can't hear. They can't praise God. Only the living can praise God. Let's try this one more time. Give God some praise. All right. Amen. 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 It's another Sunday, but it's not a regular Sunday. It's the first one in the month of February, in the year 2023, the year of new era. Let me explain what new era is. You want something different? You put in something different. And then the outcome will be different from what you had last year. If you do the same thing you did last year, you get the same result you got last year. You will be right where you were last year. Well, I heard Reverend Johnson talk about something the fasting did for her. Before we started it, I told you there was revelations in fasting and praying. Well, I'm going to leave Reverend Johnson alone. I got a certificate of license here that the Holy Spirit revealed. Sanford Cunningham has been a minister under hiding. Give guys some praise. When they transferred, the pastor, Bishop Olding, said, Sanford is a minister. So I've been waiting for the license. And he went under. Be a deacon. Okay, but he won't train for the deacon. We finished training, but he won't come back. After the fasting, on Saturday, he can tell you this. I called him. I said, do you have a license? He said, yes. I said, I need to see it. See, he's been hiding it. He's busted now. Amen. So, pray for him. Next month is our 6-year ministry. Give God some praise. Reverend Johnson is my help. It took a while to understand that. She's my help in ministry. She thought she was giving to the pulpit. Now, she's understanding different. Doesn't mean she can't come to the pulpit. But it means she knows that's not her calling. She does more things for me behind closed doors than any of you would know. Give God some praise. Next month, my pastor, Dr. Brown, is going to come. We're going to consecrate him. I said, minister, and we're going to ordain him as a deacon. We're going to have two services that day. Reverend Johnson, get with me. If you want to serve in that committee, see Reverend Johnson. We need to put something together. Maybe we could eat hot dogs afterwards. Maybe we might be in the new sanctuary the way it's looking. I ain't going to pay attention to her. She whining about hot dogs. Amen. Do we have any first-time visitors here today? We'll throw the mic at you. Yes, ma'am.
You don't have to stand up, Miss Carol. You don't have to stand up.
I'm Carolyn Crockett.
Okay.
Marquise's mother.
All right.
Yeah. Praise the Lord.
Amen.
And his goodness and his mercy.
Amen. Yeah. Amen. We're glad to have you.
I'm moving to Arkansas.
Amen.
I'm coming from Murfreesboro.
Amen.
And yeah, here I am.
Here we are. Yeah. Praise God for you. Being here. Amen. Thank you, Lord.
Good morning, y'all. This is one of my students, Tallulah. She's not going to get up because she's, you know, a teenager. No, I'm just messing with her. But she wanted to come to church with me. She's been wanting to come, so she finally got to come today. So I'm happy to have her.
Amen. Dr. Obiahu, would you stand? I know she's not going to say anything. Would you stand up? She's my niece. She's a medical doctor. Resides in Jamaica. So she's on vacation. She's the quiet one. Give it to your bride. She's over there protesting. Give it to her. Let her do some work. She already worked this morning. Let's give her double duty. Amen.
Amen. Reverend Johnson, we'll get together because we ain't doing no hot dogs. How y'all doing? How y'all doing?
She's going to buy a steak. So bring your steak knife. We don't have knife.
Good morning, church family. Okay, I have a number of things today. So let me just start. Okay, our church announcement, we are back to having Bible studies. So every Wednesday here, 6 p.m. prayer, 6:30 word study starts. If there is a ministry that you would like to start or help us with, please see Pastor and First Lady. We know that she's on her journey of healing, and we thank God for that. But please see both of them. We still have copies of the church brochure. We have a number of things back there to take, tracks and Juneteenth information, our current Bible study, all of the information that you need is back on that table, so please be sure to see. If there's anything that you need, it's back there on the table. All righty. Happy birthday to all of our members celebrating birthdays. And, I hear we have a birthday girl in the house, Oriye, sweet 16 today. Woo, 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 woo. Happiest of birthdays, Oriye. February is Black History Month, and so I am about to share a Black History moment and remember our 6th church anniversary will be March 5th, no hot dogs. And it says, but we will celebrate on the 26th. Okay. More details to come. All right. With that, I guess I'm not putting it together like that. Okay. I got the two announcements, two services. All righty. So for Black History, parents, if your child is participating, they all have, their speeches in the email. Remember, we will practice. We'll utilize some of the pop-up praise. That is the third Friday. I think it's February 16th at 6 p.m. And then we'll practice also Saturday on the 5th and encouraging all 25th, I believe. And we're encouraging all of our youth to learn their parts. Of course, I'll have the paper to help them and assist, but we really want them to recite what they've learned. But again, that's in your emails. And if you will be bringing other children with you that may want to participate, let me know. We'll include them as well, all right? Okay, so this month, Black History Month, and contrary to popular belief, we know that Black History Month was not given to us to celebrate because of its shortest month in the year. We We know that it was a merging of celebrating the birthdays of President Lincoln and Frederick Douglass. So with that, I just would like to start out by just sharing some of the things that we can take pride in and knowing that the everyday existence of the world would not be as easy or comfortable without the inventions and the creativity of Black Americans. So, what does that look like? On an everyday, if it had not been for African Americans, there would be no paper, chess, the alphabet as it is described, medicines, the golf tees, horseshoes, lawnmower, typewriter, peanut butter, paints and stains, lotions and soaps, laser fuels, pressure cooker, window cleaner, pencil sharpener, fire extinguisher, stoplight, locks, safety and shoes, your shoe lacing, lubricators, elevators, gas mask, hairbrush, heating furnace, dustpan, baby buggy, clothes dryer, curtain rod, lawn sprinkler, street sweeper, horse riding saddle, player piano, arms for record player, the super soaker, doorstop, doorknobs, toilets, furniture caster, guitars, motors, lanterns, gas burners, and I'm skipping a whole lot, kitchen tables, wrench, eye protector, air conditioning unit, clothes dresser, refrigeration controls, electric lamp, mop, fire escape ladder, the relay instrument, telephone system, the battery, electric railway system, roller coasters, helicopters, blood plasma, ice cream, potato chips, space shuttle retrieval arm, video commander, multi-stage rocket, and the list goes on and on. This is our history. Amen. And if you want a copy of this, it is back there. I literally skipped a whole lot. All righty, that's your Black History moment. Thank you. Oh, happy birthday, Kaylin, and I'll be sure to add that to the list. Thank you.
Amen. Amen. What a wonderful job. Let's get our minds ready for tithes and offering. This is a great time. You know, it's a command that we have to tithe, but this is our investing time as well. This is the best investment that you can ever do. You will never be broke. Trust me. Let's get ready to pray. Father God, we thank you for this opportunity, Lord God, as we get ready to give tithes and offerings into your storehouse, Lord God. We trust and depend on you right now for everything that we have. We thank you, Lord God, for the resources that you have given us, Lord God, to provide for our families, for each and every one right now, Lord God. And we thank you for this. In your son Jesus' name, we do pray. Amen. Amen. This is also testimony time. If anybody have a testimony they would like to share. Well, anybody got a testimony they'd like to share?
First off, I want to say I'm glad to be here with y'all today. I know y'all get to see a lot of me, you know, because I'll be working and stuff on the weekend. So that was one of my prayers for 23, was to free up some time so I can be here with my church family. And I asked the Lord to do this for me, but I did it during a time we was fasting. So a woman told me about a job on Monday, and it was fitting up with the times that I needed. You know, I prayed about it, went to the Lord, told him what I needed, and me hearing about the job that Monday, I had the job by Thursday. And not only did that happen, my mom is here too, you know. And I had talked to Sanford about this, you know, we had a conversation. And when you ask the Lord for something, he'll give it to you when you pure in heart, you really mean it. But when he give it to you, you got to understand that your part, you had to do the things that you told God that you was going to do. And that's one thing that I learned, too, is keeping the faith in God, he's going to make a way when a way look like it's impossible. So that's my testimony. He done did some other things, too, but I'm not going to get into it. It's all blessings. And it's all blessings. And I'm going to lie, I'm happy about my 23 because it done started out on the right note. Blessings are coming all year for everybody up in here. Believe. Amen.
Amen. Larry, anybody else that have a testimony they want to share?
Praise the Lord. I just want to thank God for Journey Mercies. I just came in yesterday. I'm going to spend a week here. So I want to thank God for the flights and everything was smooth. And I want to thank God for Journey Mercies and also for my family and my uncle as well. He was accommodating me in this short trip. And my cousins as well. Praise the Lord.
Thank you.
I got a big mouth. I really don't need it. But I just want to thank God for his revelation during our fasting. Some things were put to rest. Some things were healed that was broken. And I thank God most of all for his peace that came from this fasting. And it's just, I can't tell you enough that when you line up with God, there is peace. And I just thank him for that peace that he brought into my life. And I know that he's got bigger and better things ahead of me as long as I line up with him and do what he's called me to do.
Hey, y'all, again. So yesterday I shared in Sunday school how right before I was coming to a curve on Aggie Road, I literally just went into a praise and just started thanking God. Not less than a minute later, an elderly gentleman ran the red light, and it was my turn to turn. We were literally, when I say right here, and so I just want to thank God for the angelic host and his presence. When I'm talking about y'all could have just breathed, and I would have hit him. And so it was just nothing but the grace of God. And then as well, so I'm a consultant and I work with nonprofits and leaders. And there is this one client I really thought that I was not going to be able to hold the contract. She was just, you know how people say alpha females and stuff? Child. Woo. So I was like, I told my husband, I said, I think I'm going to have to wrap this contract up because she's this and she's this. But honestly, I needed to this development because she runs a $1 million organization. And so someone who's growing and she's already been doing this for 20 some years, even though I'm here to serve her as a consultant, I needed to see her blueprint, right? And because of that and just praying through some things I had to correct on myself, now there is not a place that she goes. She literally just offered me Friday. She wants to pay for my trip, hotel, registration, but she wants me to attend about 3 conferences where her all expenses paid outside of what she already pays me. So I just want to give that, that it is, Brother Marquise said it, that you do have to do some work on your end, and I just thank God for his grace in that.
Amen. Amen. Well, I guess I do want to share. I thank God for the opportunity. Like I said, this is Black History Month. I'm black all year long. But I had the opportunity, Greenbrier, where I work at, they highlighted me on their social media, you know, all across the world. They're worldwide. And it goes beyond, like, it is Black history for me because people get to see me and other people in the company to see who I am, and also to give encouragement to someone else, if, you know, when that opportunity to come up, because most people, for whatever reason, they don't want to do it. They don't want to move up or anything. But if they see me, hopefully that they will, because we are limited. And I just thank God for that opportunity and the position that he has allowed me to get. And again, Brother Marquise, what we, like you said, we was talking, and that honestly, that particular day, I had three vehicles down. It's like, I don't know what in the world is going on. Like I said, this all during the fasting. And as we was backing out of the yard, long story short, I looked, I said, Marquise, you know what? You're right. We have to change our perspective and look in a different lens when things are going bad for us. And I promise you, God, he's been a blessing, and I don't take that for granted at all. Well, this is time for our congregational song. If everybody can please stand. And then after the congregational song, the next voice will be of Reverend Dr. Greg Oter.
See the first Sunday in February. This is the month of love. This is the month of Black history. Every day is Black history. They just choose to recognize us today. Civilization started in Africa. Let's give God praise for that. I ask him to speak to you this morning. There is a word from heaven. For I have received of the Lord, which I will also deliver unto you. For it pleased God by the foolishness of preaching to save those that believe. While you're standing there, Tabitha, would you give me 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 9? He said, but as it is written, I had not seen, no ear heard, neither have entered into the heart of man the things which God has prepared for them that love him. We're going to examine the covenant power of love. You may be seated in the presence of God. The Bible records here in the second chapter of 1 Corinthians, we know Paul. Was anyone taking the kids to the back? If not, they're okay. Amen. Okay. I think they're busting out. Okay. Amen. So it tells us that ears I have not seen, nor ear heard, nor has it entered the heart of man. So let me help you this morning. That means what you see and what you are going to see when God is done with you, you've never seen. What you're going to hear, you've never heard. And what is going to enter your heart has never entered there before. Let me help you this morning. Marquise was sharing that he prayed for a job on Monday. By Thursday, he had a job. What God is saying is going to trump that. He said, while they are yet praying, I will answer. That means while you are praying on Monday, by the time you get off your knees, there's a text message for a job. That means the things that you thought is not going to be possible in this lifetime, God will make it happen before you. But there's a condition for this to happen. He says, for those that love him. This is where we fail, folks. Loving God. We tend to love ourselves more than we love God. When we love ourselves more than we love God, we don't fear God. When we don't fear God, we do everything he says not to do. That we pretend like we love God. Do you know coming to church every Sunday is not loving God? I'm sorry to disappoint you. Coming to Bible study every Wednesday is not loving God. Loving God is in action. Let me prove it to you, just so you don't think I'm criticizing you. The Bible says here, there is no fear in love. But perfect love casted out fear. Because fear had no torment. He that feareth is not made perfect in love. So what is love? Love, number one. 1 John 4:8. He that loveth not, knoweth not God. For God is love. God is love, so maybe it's outside of reach. Let me read the next scripture. 1 John 4:16. And we have known and believed the love that God had to us. God is love, and he that dwelleth in love in God, and God in him. Love is not an emotion. It's not how you feel. Your feeling is in your mind. Your intellect is in your mind. Love is an action word. And love is a choice. Can I prove it to you? Bible says in John 3:16, for God so loved, he gave. So if he didn't give, he didn't love. Let me let that sink in. So giving is living. And living is loving. So if I don't love, I won't give. If I don't give, I'm not living. Let me try it a different way. Listen carefully. I told you love is a choice. The Bible says here in John 14:15, Jesus said, if, conditional now, so it's a choice. Anytime you see if, you have a choice. If you love me, keep my commandment. So to prove that I love him, I keep his commandment. So it's not what I say. It's not how I act. It's in what I do. In obedience to his commandment. Number four, love is a command. I just read you 14:15, right? If you love me, obey my commandments. Now let's look at this. In John 13:34-35, the Bible says, a new commandment I give unto you, that you love one another. As I have loved you. Jesus has already loved us. enough to come down on earth and die for us. He said, I give you this new commandment. Love each other like I've loved you. That you also love one another. So, verse 35. He says, by this, by how I love and I express my love, shall all men know that you are my disciples. You don't have to introduce yourself. By your actions, you introduce yourself to other people. If you love one another. Today, we're talking about loving God. Write it on top of your note, loving God. That's where we start. The breath that we exchange with, we think we're breathing. We're not breathing on our own. When you see a dead person, ask them. The only reason why you're breathing is because God is still exchanging breath with you. When he withdraws his breath, you are dead. It's two deaths. I'm going to explain it later on. Number one death is you stop breathing. The second death is disobedience. You ought to be in Bible study on Wednesday. How do we love God? Number one, know him. You can't love who you don't know. You can't love who you don't know. 2 Timothy 2:15 says, study to show yourself approved unto God. A work need not be ashamed who can rightfully divide the word of truth. He didn't say preachers. He didn't say evangelists. He didn't say reverence or bishops. He said, you who is interested in knowing God, you need to study to show yourself approved. Not unto another man, unto God himself. He's the author of the Bible, so he knows how far you have read. Philippians 3:10 says, that I may know him. This is Paul writing to the church in Philippi, and the power of his resurrection, that I may know him, and the power of his resurrection, and the fellowship of his sufferings, be made conformable unto his death. Leave it up there, Tabitha. I want to know Christ and experience the mighty power that raised him from the dead. Okay, let's just slow down for a second. He says, I want to know Christ. When I know him, then I will experience the mighty power that raised him from the dead. How do we do that? I want to suffer with him, sharing in his death. How do I do that? What did Christ die to? What did he die for? He lived a sinless life for 33 and a half years. Didn't live in sin like you and I were born in. The things that attract you and I attracted him. But he shunned them so he can die this death for you and I. Somebody get this. Now that he's dead, you are living, you ought to live. By leaving the sinful things alone and live for him. Yeah. Number two, worship and praise him. The reason why we fall short of a lot of things that God wants for us, we don't love him enough to listen. We have egos. We have heights. We have intelligence. We have degrees. These things are fooling us. We think we have arrived. You haven't even started yet. Bible says you are ignorant. You are naked. But you don't know it. Why don't we know it? We are not lining up with the love of God. Listen to this. In Romans 5:8, he said, while we were yet sinning against God, he commanded his love towards us. If I could get your mind to wrap around what I just quoted. While we were stealing from God, he gave up his life so we don't die for the stealing we are doing from him. Let me put it a different way. While we were writing bounce checks to God, he was putting money in our bank account so the checks don't bounce. The money we owe him. So in order to pay him back so we could be in good stead, he's put money in our account so we could write the check and it don't bounce. This is vital, folks. This is a new year for all of us. You want to grow, you grow with us. You want to play, you play. God said this is the year of new era, so they teach it different. We got to go to a new height. We can't be playing in the sandbox with the kids. No. It's time for us to command things in the city that he has planted us in. Quit playing church. Worship and praise him. John 4, 23 and 24. The Bible says, but the hour cometh, and now is, when the true worshipers, watch this, shall worship the Father in spirit and in truth. For the Father seeketh such to worship him. Look up here. He says, true worshipers that worship the Father in the spirit first, and in the truth. Listen, listen. What you look like or what you sound like when you are worshiping God, you should not care. Okay. Do you know when you sing, you're ugly? Slow down. Think about what I'm telling you. When you do your business, you're ugly. If you're straining. When you sing the glorious song you sing for God, you're ugly. I'm trying to focus you. That means a true worshiper don't care what they look like as long as they're worshiping God in the spirit and in the truth. Your opinion about what they look like shouldn't matter. God don't hear me. God don't hear me. Look. If he says, if I tell you, praise the Lord, don't. I didn't keep you alive. I didn't say praise me. I said praise the Lord. You should raise your hand. If there's a perspiration circular, so be it. Who cares what I look like if I'm praising my God? Number three, how do I love God? Put him first. Matthew 6:33. The Bible says, but seek ye first. That means there were things that came before this. Your clothes, what you eat, what you wear, and this, that, and that. He said, but seek him, the kingdom, first. And his righteousness. So look up here. That means no matter what dealings I mean, I have no interest in cheating anyone out of anything because God is watching. He says, if I will do this, all the things people are lying to get, things people are cheating to get, will be added to me. You heard her testimony. She's consulting for a woman who has over $1 million budget, not for profit. Obviously, she's older than her. Obviously, she got more money than her. Why is she willing to pay for her? Go everywhere. Favor. If you will live right, the kings will favor you. Exodus 23, verse 3. One of the Ten Commandments, thou shalt have no other God before me. So everything you do, if God is first, sin has very little power over you if God is first. Number four, God. If you love me, obey my commandments. 1 John 5:3. For this is the love of God, that we keep his commandments. And his commandments are not grievous. Leave it up there. Loving God means keeping his commandments. So for me to prove I love God, I obey his commandments. No excuses. Look. And his commandments are not burdensome. That's what this means. There is nothing God tells me to do or not to do that hinders my progress. And put it a different way. There is nothing that God has asked me to do that is not for my advancement. There is nothing God has asked me not to do that I have a bad ending. Every commandment is geared to bless you. But can I tell you this? Obedience only delivers at the end, not at the beginning. Obedience is very costly. When everybody else is going left, and God says, go right, you're going to look like a fool. But at the end, you'll be laughing. They're going to mock you when you make that right, when they're all making a left. He says, his commandments are not grievous. That means there's no way what he asked you to do will hurt you. No way. Guaranteed. Number five, love what God loves. This is another thing. We take some and we leave some. We decide who we can't stand. We decide who we're going to like and who we're not going to like. Then we forget that every soul belongs to God. And he loves every soul. Now look at this. He said in Luke chapter 14, verse 23, and the Lord said unto the servant, go out into the highways and hedges and compel them to come in, that my house may be filled. Folks, this is his house. When was the last time you went out and asked somebody to come to church? This is God's word. Let me give you another one. In Daniel chapter 12, verse 3. And they that be wise shall shine as the brightness of the firmament. Leave it up there, Tabitha. And they that turn many to righteousness as the stars forever and ever. Do you know bringing folks in to church who are not in church will turn you into a star? Look. Those who are wise will shine as bright as the sky. And those who lead many to righteousness, what are we looking here? What are we doing here? Living righteous. Seek God's kingdom and his righteousness. Living righteous will shine like the stars forever. Did you know that bringing souls into the church who don't know Christ will make you a star? But everybody else is dying out there and put their name on the billboard. That's all you got to do. Why do you know Billy Graham? There's nobody who's an adult who doesn't know that name, Billy Graham. Was he known for his airplanes? No. What was he known for? That's it. Come to Christ. How old was he when he died? 99. Y'all don't hear me. There shall be stars, those that bring others in. Let me read you one more. 2 Peter 3:9. The Bible says the Lord is not slack concerning his promise, as some men count slackness. But is long suffering to us, were not willing that any should perish. But then he told us in Matthew 28, go ye therefore. So he says, I'm not going. I've already come and gone. I need you to go. He said, as my Father sent me, send I you. So his Father glorified him because he went. Y'all don't hear me. I'm getting so excited. His Father glorified him in John 17 because he went and did what his Father sent him to do. So he said, I'm sending you. Go do what I did and I'll glorify you. In Luke chapter 10, let me hurry up so we can take this communion. Luke chapter 10, verse 27. And he answered and said, thou shalt love the Lord thy God. So look up here. With all thy heart. With all thy soul. With all thy strength. And with all thy mind. And thy neighbor as thyself. All your heart. In Proverbs 26, 23, I think, he says, my son, give me your heart. He says, and all thy soul. What is your soul? I explain this every time I mention this. Man is a triune being. It's a spirit that lives in a body and has a soul. When you die, the spirit goes back to God. The body goes back to earth. The soul goes before God for judgment. So what is in my soul? My everyday life, that's what's written on my soul. So if I've been sinning all along, that's what's on my soul. That's what God judges. But if I give him my soul, I can't write the wrong thing on it. Just understand this so I can move on. If you live your life trying to please yourself, you might be running a danger of your soul going to hell. You're going to make mistakes, but the ones you make purposefully is the one that's going to send you to hell. The one you've heard, don't do this, I bet you're doing it because everybody's doing it. So when they go, they go. Can I submit this to you? There's not one place in the Bible where the crowd was right. Can I tell you another interesting fact? The money we kill ourselves for was not in the garden. But yet, man had everything that he needed. That's where Matthew 6:33 comes from. Listen, listen carefully. We lose focus of what we are supposed to do. We lower our expectation to money, and we fall. If I will raise my expectations to do what he says do, money will chase me. Let me say it in practical terms. Those in the finance department know how much I get paid as a stipend a month. I can't live off of that. Meanwhile, I'm not stealing. And I'm not borrowing. How? Not a magician. Don't sell drugs. Don't have anyone on the street corner. No. Here's the meat now. What are the covenant powers contained in loving God? What are the covenant powers contained in loving? What are the covenant powers? I'm going to go very quick. Number one, fearlessness. 2 Timothy 1:7. For God had not given us the spirit of fear, but of power and of love and of a sound mind. God has not given us the spirit of fear. He didn't. Fear is torment. You are fearless when you love God. 2 Corinthians 5:1. For we know that if our earthly house of this tabernacle were dissolved, we have a building of God, and house not made with hands, eternal in the heaven. English. Means if I love God, nothing bad is going to happen to me. They could go everywhere and shoot everywhere. They're not going to shoot where I am. Because until God is done with me, you can't kill me. Let me put it to you in a different way. When you hear, I am unkillable, I'm not guessing at it, folks. The Bible says I'm seated far above principalities and powers. That means what doesn't happen there can't happen to me here. As long as these hands are clean. If I'm tricking people and taking their money, then maybe your bullet can hurt me. Outside of that, there's nothing you could do. This is not a strange preaching. This is pure Bible teaching. Subscribe to what God says, and you will live a heavenly life on earth. It's not guesswork. Forget what you need is what God is interested in. But he said, put me first, and everything you need, I'll add to you. Number two, loving God conquers selfishness. This is for most of us in the Western world. Because the psychologists, they tell us to do you. By the time you finish doing you, there's nothing left. You can't even teach yourself anything doing you. Listen to me. You are with yourself all the time, so you cannot learn from yourself. The language you speak, somebody had to teach it to you. But now they tell you to do yourself. What can you learn from yourself? The only thing you can learn from yourself is pain. You want me to say it again? You know, you tell a little child to stay away from the stove. They don't listen because ears don't work all the time. But let them put that little hand on that stone one time only. Mm-hmm. So we, even as adults, God said, don't do this. Because we haven't seen anyone hurt by doing that, we think it's safe. But when the calamity comes, well, God, where are you? Well, I told you not to mess with that. Philippians 2:4. Look not every man on his own things, but every man also on the things of others. So look outside yourself. 1 Corinthians 10:24 says the same thing. Number three. Loving God conquers envy. What is envy? Sanford has a BMW. Instead of me aspiring to buy one, I want to get Sanford. At least render his inoperable. Since I can't buy one, I want to flatten his tire so he don't drive. I don't understand. Think about the things you do to stop somebody else. You're envious of. What are the thoughts you have about them? I wish they'll fall down and bust your head. Hello. That's envy. You don't want them to keep on living. You don't want them blessed by what God is blessing them. But if you love God, you don't envy anything. Because yours is coming. First Peter 2:1. Wherefore, laying aside all malice, all guile, and all hypocrisies, and envies, and all evil speaking. Proverbs 23:17. Let not thy heart envy sinners. You know, sin is enjoyable, but it's very expensive, and it will keep you too long. Mm-hmm. Number four, loving God will teach you patience. Loving God will teach you patience. A lot of us struggle with patience, but we don't understand that patience is the sister to faith. And faith, without faith, we can't please God. I didn't get this. If I don't exercise patience, I'm not pleasing God. Remember 2 Peter 3:9, I said God is not slack, he's not slow. So he knows you are sinning. Instead of him striking you, then he waits patiently that you're going to turn it around someday. But we know, me, you make me mad, I'm ready to dismiss you right now. So patience is a sister to faith. So you are praying for faith because he said without faith, it is impossible to please God. That means if I don't exercise patience, I have no faith. Without patience, my faith is useless. Galatians 6:9. And let us not be weary in well-doing, for in due season we shall reap if we faint not. Write this scripture down. Ephesians 4:2. With all lowliness and meekness, with long-suffering, forbearing one another in love. So love will teach you to be patient. Number 5, very important. Love conquers pride. Your notebook should be full today. Please study it at home. This is not any old teaching or preaching. No. We are teaching for life, to live better. 1 John 2:16. For all that is in the world. Look at this. For all, not some, that is in the world, lust of the flesh, lust of the eyes, the pride of life, is not of the Father, but is of the world. Look, for the world offers only a craving for physical pleasure, a craving for everything we see, and pride in our achievements and possessions. He said, these are not from the Father, but are from this world. So what does that tell you? For me to dress so you can think I am rich, I'm fooling myself. God is not impressed. The things I'm saying so you could call my name, God is not impressed. We as servants of God should serve God to the level that we remember what God said through him. We might not even remember his name. Y'all don't hear me. Most of us do things so our name can be remembered. That's not your place. You are disposable. Sorry to be so harsh, because one day you're going to die. I'm standing before you today alive and breathing. I work for God, but one day I'm going to be put in the box, dead. Does the Church of God stop? No. I tell people this. We are the hand that got stuck in the bucket of water. When you take it out, you look at the bucket, it don't look like anything is missing. But my hand is wet. James 4:6. But he giveth more grace. Wherefore, he said, God resisted the proud, but giveth grace to the humble. But he gives us even more grace to stand against such evil desires. As the scripture says, God opposes the proud, but gives grace to the humble. One interpretation says God sets himself against the proud, but he helps the teachable. God sets himself against the one that won't learn, but he gives help to the ones that are willing to learn. God gives grace to the professor who says, Lord, I'm at your feet. Teach me what you need me to know. That's the one he helps. But the one that has 7 PhDs in theology but won't learn, God said, I will set myself against him. That means everything he walks, God will resist him. Number six, when we love God, all circumstances work for us. In Romans 8:28, and we know that all things, not some things, that all things work together for good to them that love God and to them who are called according to his purpose. No matter what it looks like, if I love God, no matter what it looks like, let me say it again, no matter what it looks like, God will cause them to work together for my good, as long as I love him. And how do I prove I love him? I already shared that with you. He said, go out. You said, no, I don't feel like going outside. You're not in that love category. Better check your love. Number seven, when we love God, he answers our prayers. He answers our prayer. John 15:7. If, here's that word again, if. So it's a choice. If, look up here. Look at the screen. If you, not them, if you abide in me and my words abide in you. So remember 2 Timothy 2:15, study to show yourself approved unto God. The workman need not be ashamed who can rightfully divide the word of truth. He said, if you abide in me and my words, plural, abide in you, and ye ask what you will, and it shall be done unto you. I stay in the word of God, and I know the word of God, so I ask in the word of God. I will get what I need. 1 John 5. He says, this is the confidence that we have in him, that if, here we go again, we ask anything according to his will. Hello. His will is his word. His will is his word. You want anything from God? Tell him what he said in the Bible. And he said, you have it. Verse 15. And if we know that he hears us, whatsoever we ask, we know that we have the petition that we desired of him. Finally, number eight. Love never fails. Loving God never, put the word never, emphasis on never, fails. Love never fails. The Bible says, 1 Corinthians 13:8. All the teaching today, you can go to 1 Corinthians 13:4-8. All that I'm teaching you today, I have a part. So go read it for yourself. 1 Corinthians 13:8 says this. Charity never faileth. Charity here is love. But whether there be prophecies, they shall fail. Whether there be tongues, they shall cease. Whether there be knowledge, it shall vanish away. But love never fails. Look up here as we close. If you truly love God and demonstrate your love for God, remember this. Loving God is not one level. It's several levels. The more you learn, the more you love God. At whatever level you are, you cannot fail. and let that sink in. Your human efforts does not compare to the speed God gives you if you love him at the level where you are. But you need to prove to him that you love him. Give God some praise. We see First Lady says, good morning, church. And Miss Nyla Jones says, good morning, church. Amen. So, the love of God. Because next week we'll talk about a different kind of love. This is the time in our service where we open the door of the church for anyone that does not have a church home. And you want to join this body of as believers. Or if you are a candidate that needs to be baptized, the door is open. We're making arrangements to baptize your great-grandson, Kirion. He's been asking for a while. I put him off and said, until you turn 8, when he turned 8, he reminded me. Amen. So, is there any today? Amen. For Israel be lost, Jacob shall not lose his reward. Amen. Amen. The reason why I tell you, for Israel be lost, Jacob shall not lose his reward. I might be a sinner. That was Jacob. Israel is the son of God. So the son of God gets lost. The liar will get his reward. Know why? Because he told you was what God said. So when I say that, I'm telling you, I've said to you what he said for me to tell you. If you don't receive it, I will receive my reward. Give God some praise. We don't want to say anything in this ministry that people have to guess what you mean. I'm not interested in that. I'm simple-minded. I have more questions than I have answers. So the way the Lord uses me is, I ask him, when he sends me to preach this, I say, okay, but what about this one? I ask more questions, and by him answering my questions, that's what you hear. Give God some praise. So our first Sunday, as our tradition is, the Holy Communion Sunday. Deacon Williams, would you offer prayers for the elements? You remain where you are, all of you. From this day, it's no longer Brother Sanford Cunningham, is now Minister Sanford Cunningham. So you are going to assist me just like Reverend Johnson is assisting me. These two will serve the communion. I know it's your month. We know what's going to happen by the end of the month, right? Are you looking at me, sir? Amen. Communion. You may take your seats for a minute. Take your seats for a second. It's like I designed it. Two over here and two over there. All right. So this Holy Communion that we do every Sunday, what does this signify? Jesus said, in the night of the Passover, he was eating the Passover meal with his disciples. The Bible says he took bread. He blessed it. He broke it and gave it to them. I said, this is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me. Now, the Bible says he took the cup and supped and said, this cup is the cup of the new covenant. So what is a covenant? Covenant means it's an agreement between two parties with well-defined terms where God tells you, if you do this, I will do this. So as long as you do what God says, he's committed to do what he said he will do. That means the covenant of love has the same power. In Songs of Solomon chapter 8 verse 6, the Bible says that love is as strong as death. So we know when death gets a hold of you, you are coming with it. So a love of God, if he gets hold of it, you are going with God. Let me help you. That means the Bible says that the sea saw the Israelites and fled. It wasn't the Israelites the sea saw. It was the God in them that the sea saw and fled. So, in 1 Corinthians, in John 6:53, the Bible says that then Jesus said unto them, verily, verily, I say unto you, except you eat the flesh of the Son of Man, that's the bread he broke, and drink his blood, that's the wine, ye have no life in you. So until you believe that the elements that Deacon Williams has prayed for is now the body and the blood of Christ, you have no life in you. I'm not done. Not done. He says here, there's revelation in this. Luke 24, verses 30 through 31. We just came out of prayer and fasting, right? So this is another avenue for revelation. The Bible says here, and it came to pass, as he sat at meat with them, he took bread and blessed it and brake and gave to them, and their eyes were opened. Then he vanished out of their sight. They were with him during the day. They couldn't recognize him. Listen to me. He was walking with them during the day. They were going to the village called Emmaus. Emmaus, okay, what he said. They didn't know who he was during the day. Then at nighttime, they said, come eat with us. He took that same communion, broke it, blessed it, gave it to them, their eyes were open. Revelation. What they couldn't see during the day, they saw at night. It's healing in the communion. 1 Corinthians 11, 29 and 30. For he that eateth and drinketh unworthily, eateth and drinketh damnation to himself, not discerning the Lord's body. For this cause, many are weak and sickly among you, and many sleep. What is the unworthiness or the unworthiness of taking the communion? Christ had no sin in him. So he gave you his sinless body to consume. But in your body, listen to me, every sin has to be confessed. He said, if you take it with sin unconfessed, it will make you sick. And some have died because they took it unworthily. That's healing. So if I could die or if he could make me sick, because I did. What if I did confess? That disease they have no idea what to do with. That couldn't survive in Christ, it won't be there anymore. Give God some praise. Rise to your feet, deacons. Serve the people. Thank you, Lord. Nana left us, and Carmen is not here. Who's singing? Mr. Cunningham?
And I know it was the blood for me. They whipped him all night long. They whipped him all night long. They whipped him all night long for me. One day when I was lost, he died upon the cross, and I know it was the blood for me. They crucified my Lord. They crucified my Lord. They crucified my Lord for me. He died upon the cross, and I know it was the blood for me.
While we're waiting for those in the back to be served, I need you to bow your heads. Ask God for forgiveness for anything and everything you might have offended him. Remember what the Bible said, if you take this unworthily, it can make you sick. Some have died from this. So confess your sins, whatever you know you weren't supposed to have done that you did or said or thought. This is your time to confess. He said, if you confess your sins, he's faithful to forgive you and cleanse you of all unrighteousness. Amen. 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 Lift up the bread. This is the body. Lord Jesus. Everyone ready? Marquise, you got it back there? The big fingers are yours. Lord Jesus, this is your body. This is your sinless body that was broken for me. I take it in faith. They can eat. Lord Jesus, this is your blood that was shed on Calvary for the remission of sins. The word says, without the blood, there is no life in the body. Take it. Father God, we thank you. We bless you for giving us the opportunity to ingest your flesh and your blood. We pray for healings to take place. Supernatural healings and empowerment. We shall forever give you praise and give you glory. In Jesus' name we pray. Every heart said amen. 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 Give God some praise wherever you are. We ready to go?
Ready to go? The Bible says, how good is it, how pleasant is it to dwell together in one accord? Since morning we've been together, we sang together, we had the word of God together, and now we are going to bless one another in our usual way. So for those who are not accustomed to Psalm 23, verse 6, we normally say, surely, at the end, So we just say it together. First and foremost, you bless your neighbor. And secondly, you now bless yourself. After two, one, two, go.
Surely, God's goodness and mercy shall follow you all the days of your life, and you shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Amen.
Now ourselves, surely, God's goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Amen. Altar, sir.
Now unto him. Unto him who is able to keep us all from falling. Unto him who loved us first. Unto him, with him we can never fail. Be the power, dominion, and majesty. Every heart said amen. 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 And amen. Go in peace. Go in peace.
Did you get something back there?